right, our final talk of the day is going to be a panel called Prioritizing Threats, What Would Threat Researchers Do? I'll let AJ Nash introduce his panelists, but yeah, the whole team can come on up.
A little energy left. I know we're getting near the end of the day, right? All right, so is this working?
Yeah, good.
We're short one mic, so I guess I'm going to stand up here today. That'll be fine, though. All right, so my name's AJ Nash. I'm the Director of Cyber Intelligence Strategy for Anomali. Quick background on myself, then we'll go to the panel, and then we'll jump into the discussion here. For myself, I got about 18 years in the government space, 9 as a military member, and then 9 more as a contractor. So I'm a traditional intelligence guy, counterterrorism, counterinsurgency, countering trafficking of persons and chasing war criminals, that kind of thing. It's been about 5 years counting threats in cyber. Been in the private sector now for about 5 years, and primarily my role is either building intelligence programs or helping people build intelligence programs. So I'm really honored to be on this panel today or working with these guys. It's a really great group, and I'm really looking forward to a lively discussion. So with that, I'm going to pass it over to Chris, and he can introduce himself.
How's it going? Chris Cochran. I lead threat intelligence at Netflix, also co-host of the Hacker Rally Studio podcast. Really focused on program building, optimization, things like that.
Tim Gallo. I'm in solutions architecture and intelligence for FireEye Mandiant. I work with a lot of our clients developing intelligence operations, but I also work closely with our intelligence teams inside FireEye Mandiant on productions as well. I've been doing this for, I guess it's been like 20 years. Gosh, I'm old. Yeah.
I'm John DiMaggio. I work for Symantec, and I chase bad guys for a living.
Nice.
John's a man of few words. All right, so let's talk about building intelligence programs. So we're going to run through this relatively quickly. Obviously, we have a short amount of time, and the goal is really to talk about sort of the meat of this discussion, which is a little bit more technical, but we do want to give some background and overview of where we're going.
Actually going to interrupt right now.
Absolutely.
Before we even start.
Let's do it.
So just by a show of hands, everybody in the room here, how many people are security people and how many people are intelligence people? I like to ask this question to kind of get an idea.
Yeah.
So raise hands if you're a traditional intelligence person first. So there's
one back there,
yeah,
one
like
over here.
There's like
3%
half
of the room.
A dozen, yeah.
Yeah, like 3% of the room. So
one over here. I got you.
Okay. Traditional security people, whether blue or red.
Right.
Okay. So just wanted to, so now we kind of know where we're at. And I think it's important to know kind of where we are in the room. So who we're talking to.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point, Tim. Thanks. And it leads into a really strong discussion. Because what we've been seeing in the private sector, so obviously all four of us mentioned we have a government background and some traditional intelligence background. And we've seen over the last 5 to 10 years the push into the private sector to build intelligence programs. And primarily now the challenge we're running into, I think, and Chris, I know you'll talk to this here, is making sure that we're getting a unified approach. So intelligence isn't its own thing over here, with operations its own thing over here, and never the two shall meet. The goal is to work together. So it's great to have an audience that's primarily not intelligence folks, because these are the people we work for and support, right?
Yeah.
All right, so when we talk about building programs, what you're seeing up here, I'm gonna let this whole slide build, just so we can save a little time on it, is the intelligence cycle, right? The traditional intelligence cycle. So it starts with planning and direction, which normally starts with trying to identify stakeholders and develop some intelligence requirements, which I think is an area where a lot of organizations are really falling down right now, is they understand they need intelligence, but that's about as far as we're getting. And again, the practitioners like yourselves, you're the customers. So Intel needs to be working with you all to help develop these requirements. So Chris, you've been building a pretty strong team at Netflix. How are you attacking this?
So one of the biggest issues I see when you look at intelligence from an operational perspective is actual integrations within not only the security function, but then also the business. One of the things that I sort of have been championing is how to operationalize like intelligence. So you see the intelligence cycle right here. This is something that your junior analyst is going to understand if they have that intelligence background. But I came up with this framework called the EZ framework. And what it does is it sort of creates this touch point for operations. So E is a list of requirements, like AJ was just talking about. Requirements is like your foundation of your intelligence program. You need to understand what your stakeholders and all the people that you're going to be supporting are going to need to do their operations. What decisions are they going to have to make? What information do they wish they had at one point when they were, you know, covering an incident or investigating some event? The next thing is assess collection plan, which we're going to talk at great length, I think, is the collection plan. And whenever you have those requirements, the collection plan is how you get that information. And whenever you have new requirements, you're going to actually have to adjust it, as I'm sure you would.
Oh, agree, absolutely. Right? No, that's a great point. It's making sure you don't just do it as a one-time thing.
Right.
So Tim and John, you guys are representing the stronger, smarter portion of the panel today. The guys are actually...
Wow. I resent that. Well, pretty smart.
I didn't say they were representing the prettier portion of the panel, Chris.
But so you guys often are the ones who have to execute, right? I mean, mm-hmm. you're the smarter group, quite frankly. So how do you execute against Intel requirements that you're getting and provide the kind of value that folks are looking for? How do you make sure what you're doing fits what they're needing?
I mean, to a point, you can't, obviously, you can't invent the news. So you need to be focused into whatever the area is, obviously, that... you know, are important to your customer, whether that customer be, you know, government, whether it be commercial or some third party. But the point being is, I think there's a lot of misunderstanding in like requirements. We want you to find something in healthcare. We want you to find something in, you know, aerospace. Clearly, there's threats in all of those areas, but you need to sort of be tuned in. You can't just, you know, push a button and find something with that, at least not you know, the advanced targeted type of situation. So I think having the right people in the right place that can do that for you is the most important part. Having the human analyst that can actually go in and find that, to me, that's the most important part of this process, because with the right framework and tools, you're not going to get the end result that you want. Same time, without the right, you know, having the right people, but not having the tools or the infrastructure for yourself as well, is going to cause the same problem.
So I'm actually, I think when I think about this, like from a requirements perspective, it almost actually, when I think about hiring the appropriate individuals and getting the tools in place for them, requirements also drive that, right? It drives our JDMs
sure.
mm-hmm. to make sure that we're getting people that marry to the business needs of our clients. Whether I think of myself in Chris's position as creating intelligence for an organization and they are my client, or from our positions where we're vendors, putting out intelligence across a number of client sets. So those become JDMs ostensibly that allow you to say, okay, well, if this is the requirements base for a client set, whether that is, you know, looking at nation state or looking at criminal or looking at hacktivism, and also I need these linguistic capabilities, all of those become those frameworks. And so that those requirements not only lead to our technical collections plans, but I think they have to lead to our human resources collections capabilities as well, which is sad to say, I mean, that humans are resources, but ultimately we are.
Yeah, I mean, I think though, as a threat hunter, that you have to have that human ability to understand the information. We can all get an appliance that tells us something flashes red and it's bad, but what does that really mean? You need a human being in order to make that something that's actionable that you can actually use.
100% agree.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I didn't throw it in the deck today, but the math equation I normally talk about is talent times access times time as sort of the three elements of doing anything with intelligence, right? You have to have the talent. You can't do it without people. People who've been trying to automate intelligence forever. All of us spent time at agencies that have said for years, we're not going to have jobs. And lo and behold, there's still a lot of Intel analysts out there. So you can't do that. But again, you have to have access. You have to have the right tools, the right opportunities to have something to actually analyze and the right materials, right? And then there's always some element of time that goes with it. So I think that what you guys are saying fits right with that. So, all right, so we talked about planning a direction, so collection. You know, Chris, you mentioned that, talking about building a collection plan, and we talked a little bit about vendor selection. So this is, I find this to be really challenging when I work with prospective clients or existing clients to help them understand the importance of a diverse collection plan. Because obviously when you're on the vendor side, it sounds like I'm just trying to get people to spend a lot of money. But the reality is you can't do this with just one or two sources, quite frankly. You have to develop really a wide-ranging collection plan that covers multiple different categories of material with as much redundancy as you can afford. There's a point when you've spent too much, and that's why you have to analyze what your needs are, of course. But I'm interested to see, again, Chris, I'm gonna turn it back to you on this since you're building this program at Netflix, and you've come a long way at this point. So talk to me a little bit about what you can from Netflix, about your collection plan and how you went about this.
Yeah, so I like to look at it in different buckets of information. So you have your premium sources, right? So you can look at these as like your closed feeds. Mm-hmm. You have to pay to get access. But then there are other things, you know, as simple as Twitter. Like if you follow the right researchers, the people that are on the forefront of research, that's another collection source. And then things that are just open source, things that are just, you have companies that are putting out free information all the time, and being able to distill all that stuff down to a digestible thing is gonna be where the problem is. One thing that I tell other companies, other programs, in, when they're looking at collection, like where do you start? You start with looking at, you know, the ISACs that you might belong to. You look at the people that are in your vertical. Where have they found their the biggest bang for their buck? You know, getting that jump start is a good way to start when you're looking at collection.
That's a really good point. The ISACs, of course, I'm curious. I don't want to go too far into the ISAC discussion, but one of the things I've noticed, I want to see if you guys have seen the same thing, all three of you guys. The challenge with ISACs being that people want the information but don't often want to give the information. Like, how well is that working from your experiences working with ISACs? Do we need more sharing? Is it getting better? Where are we at right now, do you guys think?
I mean, my experience historically has been the ISACs tend to be, everybody wants to absorb and very few people want to give back. It's there's not a lot that I've found that has really driven the model of anonymized information sharing back to the ISACs, because it all becomes ultimately attributable back to some shared source from, you know, the compromised entity or whatever that's sharing information back, which is the risk and which is why people don't want to do it. Or at least that's, again, my experience.
Yep.
I think it's getting better as more technological platforms come into play that allow for better anonymization of the metadata there. Mm-hmm. But I still don't. It's still not perfect, and it's still organizations see it as a risk to open themselves up to potentially letting information out that they don't want to.
I think it's a two-part thing. So on the one part, usually when I get involved with ISAC programs, it's to share information or to present information, but that's just sort of a direct result of the role of what I do for my job. At the same time, let's look at a real world example, and I might have some of the dates off here, but you know, we're all familiar with, you know, North Korea being behind some of the Lazarus being behind some of the SWIFT attacks. You know, the Bank of Bangladesh, that was huge, but that was 2015, 2016. Mm-hmm. Well, it was like 2013, I believe, there was another bank that was only lost $200,000. It was almost like a dry run. Yeah. It was the exact same attack. Details of that were not shared until after the Bangladesh piece came out. My point being is that right there shows whether I believe in an ISAC or you have a different opinion or whatever, it shows that there is value in that. By sharing that information and getting that out with other banks within the industry, it has helped to get that, you know, get those IOCs, get a better understanding of what's happening, and to help prevent that from taking place. So imagine if that actually had happened back in, again, whatever it was, 2012 or 2013. You know, maybe that would not have happened in 2016. We would have already had the framework in place, and you know, they would have came up with something new and creative, because North Korea always does, but the point is that we'd be a step ahead at least. So I do think there's a lot of value in those programs.
Yeah, and I agree with both of you. The way I kind of look at it, ISAC is almost like a conference. You have people that just go, show up, they sit in the sessions and they leave. But you have those people that are vocal about sharing, and that's when you start to create that tight-knit group of folks that share. The ones that are gonna say, oh, I saw this doing some research, Chris, you might wanna check this out and let some folks know. And so that's how I kind of look at ISACs.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
how they're most effective, ultimately.
Right.
That's how they have to be effective.
Yep.
The traditional models that we've had in place just simply don't do that.
Right.
And it's only through the community itself, like getting engaged and people like you actually, you know, forcing this communication metric and making it multi, you know, more than just one way, I think is
right.
the only way we can do that.
I think that's a great point, guys. All right, so if you're in an ISAC, start sharing information. all right, so I'm gonna move a little quicker through these. I don't wanna spend too much time on the academics. I know you guys wanna hear the real detailed stuff from these guys. So processing, that's where your technologies come in best, right? If you're doing with threat intelligence platforms, when people talk about AI or machine learning, if they actually are real, and you gotta talk to vendors, figure out who's telling the truth or not. But this is where technology comes into place. The goal here is to move the pendulum a bit, right? Generally speaking, you spend about 80% of your time on research and maybe only 20% doing the actual work of intelligence. The idea with technology is to drive the other direction. And I think processing is where it happens. So it's very technology layered. Analysis of production. Now we're getting into tradecraft and standards. This is where I see most organizations falling down, along with obviously playing a direction, is we've decided we want to build intel teams, and then we don't hire intelligence professionals to do that. because most of the industry doesn't know where to find them yet. So we move our IR person, our best IR, our smart person, you know, brilliant gal or a brilliant guy, we move them over and put them in charge of Intel, but that's not the same mindset and that's not the same background. So it's incredibly important, I think, to make sure that you have proper tradecraft and standards, which generally means hiring people from the intelligence community, unless you've got somebody who's just had a passion for it and drives down the path of all sorts of education to go down there. So Chris, I'm gonna turn it back to you on this one for tradecraft and standards. I'm biased towards the intelligence community directives. It's the one I tend to follow when I build programs, but I'm curious what you guys are using for standards. I'll start with you and then see what you guys think too.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good place to start, but I tend to have a more, I guess, surgical approach to doing intelligence where, like, so for instance, my easy button, the S is strive for impact. And you could do everything in the world, you know, from the government, you can, you know, adopt different standards and things like that, but what you're really looking for is impact into the organization. Mm-hmm. And so however you do that is what's going to be paramount. So if you're taking all of your resources, all your personnel, and you're doing a weekly Intel report, but then nothing is actually getting done from that weekly Intel report, you're missing the boat. Mm-hmm. So if you have to go more tactical and you're doing smaller things and you're sending it to your hunt team, you're sending it to IR, you're sending it to folks that, you know, manage your firewalls, stuff like that. That's where you really get to the meat of what Intel is supposed to be doing.
I think it's a really good point. What about you guys?
So there's two things. One, the idea of starting with the impact as sort of the growth point into building a larger right. tradecraft as you move up the business model, right?
Yep.
Move outside of the SOC, outside of the incident response organization and into the lines of business and ultimately into the business itself, right? As you're yep. driving strategic direction. That way you can show incremental growth throughout the program. That's super cool. For me, the other thing that I think is important is, you know, yeah, we can start to bring people from the Intel community, and we're going to continue to do that. We can find people that have been educated on this. What I've found is there's some areas of neural diversity from an educational perspective that are really interesting. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people who have degrees in journalism mm-hmm. that aren't doing much with it, unfortunately. But ultimately, right, when you're writing yep. a good paper or a good
natural researchers,
yep.
exactly.
Yeah.
Those are people that I think, if we're building an analytic, you know, like that, it's a very simple process to turn their journalistic capabilities into tradecraft.
Absolutely,
it's not very different, and I yep. think they're a resource that we could bring in, and they're not necessarily technical, right? These are people that have passions and research capabilities that would be fantastic in an Intel program.
Yep,
that's good thinking.
I think that just these guys have hit on a lot of good points, so I'm not going to repeat some of the things that they've said. But I guess the one thing I'd add to that is, you know, finding individuals that are not only able to find threats. Threat hunters, things of that nature, but actually having ones that can communicate, whether that be in writing, whether it be verbally. A lot of the problems that we have is we get this information and it stays in the zeros and ones because it can't be communicated well to whether it be management, whether mm-hmm. it be to your customer or whoever it is. And I think that finding individuals that, one, get it, but two, can put that narrative to it and discuss it in a way that anyone or whoever that audience is can understand is imperative to creating these teams. You need to have at least one of those that can do that. And I find that a lot of teams have incredibly smart individuals working for them, but that's where it's missed, is we can't communicate that. I can't have a conversation with someone who's not, you know, a malware analyst and convey the information and get them to understand the risk, or the exact opposite, being something that's minimalistic, but in the way that I present the information sounds like the end of the world is coming. Mm-hmm. So I think it's very important to have the right people, and I know I'm very repetitive on this, but I'm big on the people component, because we kill it with the software piece of the industry, and obviously that's what the base that drives it, but you gotta have the right people that can find it, discuss it, analyze it, correlate it, and communicate it.
No, I think that's a great point you make. You know, it's the language is a huge part of intelligence, right? And it doesn't do you any good if you can't communicate it and the recipient doesn't understand it and can't make sense of it. And a lot of times, as you said, this is incredibly technical work, and then we have to communicate that to an executive audience that may or may not be technical. They need to understand why it matters. So I've found organizations that try to find unicorns, and there's a few of them out there, but I don't know many people that are amazing reversers that also write amazing prose. It just tends to be a different, you know, right brain, left brain sort of a thing. So I've always found building teams where I have researchers and analysts over here, and then I have analyst reporters over here. And you know, these folks have to have enough technology to talk to these folks, and these folks have to have enough social skills to get along in some way. But we figure out a way to make that work, right? But don't try to find the person who can go soup to nuts. I know three of them in the entire industry that can do reversing all the way to writing great product.
Me,
it's just too
else?
Hard.
I'm
That's
joking.
True, it's John and two others.
I'm not a malware engineer, I would reverse it, I was just kidding.
So the last piece on here, and we're gonna move along, is just dissemination. Obviously you have to find a way to get intelligence to people. You can do that whether you do it through a platform, like a threat intelligence platform, whether you do that through email, text, Slack. I've seen lots of different ways to do this. There isn't a wrong answer. I would just say be careful to make sure that you have a closed environment when you do it. You don't want your material to get out. Make sure you have proper classification markings, things of that nature. So I don't think we have to belabor the point. You have to be able to share information at some point.
I do want to say two things real quickly about dissemination. One is make sure it's in a medium that your team is going to be able to digest.
Yes.
Some teams work solely in Slack and they don't work anywhere else. So if you're going to send them an email with a PowerPoint attached to it, then it's just nothing's going to happen. The other thing is having a way of feedback so that your stakeholders are actually able to let you know how the product is and then also how the program writ large is. Mm-hmm. And so you can have that iterative growth of the program to be able to support these functions better.
Oh, I think that's great points. The arrow actually in that graphic represents feedback. I just didn't happen to write it, so that's a good point. And when you mentioned the type, right? So the last position I was in building a program was at Symantec, actually. And when I interviewed the CSO to start building that, as we did requirements, I learned that that's somebody who really listens to podcasts. He's got a long commute in, listens to podcasts. We hadn't even thought about using podcasts as dissemination, but based on that discussion, we said, hey, we can do a multimedia piece, we can do podcasts. And as you said, some of our technical folks, we built a Slack channel just for one of the teams. That's all they were gonna take was Slack anyway, so we built them a dedicated Slack channel. They had a bat line back to the Intel team. Yeah. So I think that's a great point. When you interview your internal customers, and you start figuring out your stakeholders, one of the questions I often ask is, how do you currently ingest? What works best for you? Is it written? Is it audio? Is it visual? Whatever it might be, right?
Right.
So I think that's a great point. All right, let's jump ahead here, because I want to make sure we get time for the really cool stuff. All right, so we talk about some of the challenges that are facing researchers and hunters. So the first question I wanted to ask was about the evolution of adversaries. So Tim, I know you and John, the best thing about having these guys on the panel, besides the fact they're very bright, is you guys look at things differently, right? So this is a question that's perfect, I think, for you, and that we want to talk about. How do you handle changes in adversary tactics and techniques, and how do you analyze those both from a very technical standpoint and also from sort of a social cultural standpoint of the adversaries as you understand them? So John, you want to go first on that?
Sure, yeah. I think that one of the most important things, and this is something that I argue a lot and I beat to death, is you have to follow the evidence. I don't care if you think that it's country X or bad guy Y, or if you've seen this one component that you are just sold on that it's attributed to a specific entity. I think that whether it's an attribution or in anything else in attacks, you have to look at it with fresh eyes, not be biased, and follow the evidence and let it build out the bigger picture. Also, and this might be getting a little outside of the box of what you're asking, but I think you also have to look at similar activity in that same general time frame and do a look back, because as we've seen in the news a lot of times, let's just use supply chain attacks as an example. You know, there's one component. If you don't take a step back and try and see the other pieces of the attack itself, you're going to miss the big picture and what's actually taking place. So I think that we get stuck in a lot of the zeroing in too close to what's actually taking place. But I do believe that following the evidence, trying to remain unbiased and building a picture that can be backed up and supported of what you found in the attack is how you have to approach these.
So I think it's important to follow the evidence. I think that is absolutely the key aspect for all of us to be able to do what we do. Is it's an investigation ultimately, right? We're performing large scale investigations and analysis. Some of it, I think, isn't necessarily technical evidence, though, too. I think we have to take a look back at greater socioeconomic and political situations as well,
great,
which is part of the evidence, ultimately. And that's where we move outside of sometimes the activity necessarily as the leading indicators as part of our investigations, but the motivations themselves and understanding that at the high level and say, okay, well, what are these various motivations and how do these players strategically interact with the various markets that they're dealing with? and then play that back down to, okay, now we've got all this evidence. Where does this evidence lie in specific motivational techniques?
Yeah, if I could jump in and interrupt, but what Tim just said, I love, and I absolutely agree, and I think it's something that many of us don't understand. Being a good threat hunter today, especially if you're in like a top 2000 type of a company, you have to have a grasp on what's going on in the world, what motivates or benefits one region over another, and that is, like he said, not to just repeat it, but economic, military, government, all of those things can lead to motivations and having a better understanding that, while circumstantial, build the bigger picture of what you're dealing with. And you know, if you think that just because that you make widgets that your company is not going to be targeted by APT or by a nation state, I can tell you flat out you're wrong. It happens every day, and we're like, why would they want this? It doesn't matter why, it's happening.
Well, and you guys jumped right into the next bullet point, right? So the changing tools and mindsets of researchers and hunters. You know, you sort of stepped there, which is perfect timing.
And it's backwards to me, so I couldn't see it.
That's right. That's right. You can't see the board. But I'm curious what you guys have seen in this area, say in the last, 5, 10 years, probably 5 is where we've seen a lot of movement, in terms of what has changed there. You know, threat actors, 5 years ago, maybe financials were the most important. You guys will fill in the blanks here. But what have you seen over the last 5 years, both in their motivations and what kind of tools and techniques have changed? And then how have you guys responded? What kind of tools have you picked up or different techniques you've picked up to respond to that? I mean, it's a constant cat and mouse game, right?
Yeah, I mean, like 5 years ago, we were positing that ransomware would become an enterprise problem.
You posited that in the book, actually.
Yeah, but I mean, it was...
You're too humble to say
big
that.
Bet.
We were coming up with the conclusions that it was going to become a problem, and now there's been pretty much everybody today has talked about ransomware, whether it's been in the OT side of things, whether it's been in the financials, but it's become an enterprise-wide problem. And that's part of it. And I think understanding that a lot of the custom-made tools that 10 years ago when we were doing this analysis and we're looking at signatures within a toolkit to be able to identify a group because it was a specific piece of malware, now that has spread out, I think so much more significantly that just recognizing a single piece of malicious code or a series of staged loaders and C2s isn't necessarily going to give you that full set of attribution anymore, because there's a lot of shared code bases between these folks, as well as shared business models on the back end, whether it's ransomware as a service or organizations that are strictly just developing malicious code from a mercenary perspective. So as a hunter now, you've got to look, instead of being able to just focus on having a great reverse engineering team, you do have to have so much more visibility into what's potentially going to happen and what do the injects look like? What is the reconnaissance methodology that's been used as part of this attack? And does that marry with anything else? I mean, that's just starting where I'm at. There's millions of stuff.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Just want to piggyback off of that. My best friend and co-host, Ron Eddings, he's in the crowd right here. He turned me onto a book by Cal Newport called Be So Good They Can't Ignore You. And there's a concept in that book called being in the adjacent possible. And this, when you have researchers that are on the forefront of their field, will come to discoveries and conclusions at the same time, just because they're on the cusp of that. I feel like both on the adversarial side and then also on the practitioner side, we're like heading up this mountain all at the same time, because they're trying to find the holes and the problems before we do, and we're doing the same thing. So the more researchers that could live in that adjacent possible, we could either beat them to the punch and close those holes, or at least be able to remediate quickly.
And I guess I'm going to take it on a little bit different what the question was asked on 2 points. One, how mindset has changed. That wasn't, we talked about 5 years ago. I used to go into security analyst jobs, and I'd have a deck, and I would sit there and print it out I bring with me, and I'd sit there and I'd try to explain to a potential employer why they needed somebody like me, that it's almost like the difference between being a detective or a police officer, to understand why you need somebody more than just the guy to stop the threat, why you need somebody to investigate, all the other details. It's, you know, look at it like a mob hit. You'd want to know who is associated with the person, you know, who are their other, you know, crime family members, whatever it might be. What have they done in the past? How did they conduct these attacks? What else can we expect? So trying to get that mindset to change, and I think it really has. Now I think that that's something that's sought after fairly on a regular basis. And then I'll give you an example. It's a little embarrassing story, but I think it proves a point. As an analyst, you also have to change, or threat hunter, you have to change your mindset. You can't go into things because you've seen it 100 times and think you know something. I specialize in nation states. I have since branched out and I do lots of other stuff as well, but that's my expertise. And you know, when WannaCry came out, the morning of it, I think it was May 12th, you know, my boss sent me this to look at, and I literally, the guy next to me, I said, why the hell do they got us looking at ransomware? Boy, did I put my foot in my mouth, and I know being the biggest cyber threat that the world's seen today, the way that it hit. But my point is that was the wrong mindset to have. It doesn't matter the details. You've got to look at each threat with an open mind and approach it in that way.
That's a great point. Yeah, WannaCry, for anybody who might not know, prior to that, ransomware was just thought as crimeware always. Like, no nation state cared about doing this. And then WannaCry hits, and you know, we're well aware of what North Korea is capable of now. All right, so the last piece, it's interesting, we talked about North Korea. So we're going to save part of this, I know, for the next discussion, but I want to talk a little bit about attribution, or at least get your opinions on it. So I'm curious about a couple of things with attribution. First, and this one I'm going to ask you, Chris, okay. And then for you guys, the second piece. So the first one is, is it important, and if so, how much to somebody like you? Mm-hmm. And then the follow-up question for you guys is, you know, what kind of criteria do you have to put together to get to some level of confidence in a world where, as you said, you know, Tim, you've got organizations that are sharing so much now, and you know, tools are being reused, and tactics are being reused, and architecture is being reused. People are renting space. So the first question again, mm-hmm. how important is this, and what do you do with it? And the second one for you guys is, what are your criteria? How do you get something confident?
Yeah, I think the bigger answer is it depends, and that's always the favorite answer of all time. But for me, I sort of downplay attribution because I'm less interested in who and more of the what and the how. Like, what are the gaps that we need to close from a security posture perspective in order to like keep this from happening again? I do feel like the good thing about attribution is it provides context. It helps you with that narrative when you're speaking to the C-suite, or you're talking to people on the board, or even within like security leadership. I think their narrative is important. But I tend to say it depends.
Okay. How about you guys? Now you're on the vendor side, so there's a little different angle there. Yeah. But how do you view the importance of attribution? And again, with it being such a confusing world at this point, how do you guys get to something you're confident about in terms of attribution?
So confident is an important word, actually.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that often gets lost in translation between intelligence and security, is the idea of confidence ratings, right? Because in the security side of things, we can, you know, there's this idea of hard and fast security metrics, ostensibly, right? You can assess something to a specific level or a specific value. And instead, when we're writing reports, we use high confidence or moderate confidence or low confidence in our narratives, which have some semblance of a numerical value, but that's really kind of fuzzy, ultimately. Mm-hmm. And the reason that we do that is because unless you're sitting there on their system when they're generating the piece of malicious code that they're ready to deploy as part of their stage one, you don't know. So you have to take in the preponderance of evidence in order to generate a series of hypotheses that you can then either refute or validate. And by presenting those hypotheses to peers in your organization with different biases, it'll allow you to ultimately make that attribution. Now, is it important? I think it is, because it, depending upon, you know, what you're looking at, it's going to lie down to where they're, you know, what's the underlying reasoning behind a specific actor's, you know, attack matrix. What are they trying to do over the next 5 years? Are they mm-hmm. supporting this portion of a nation state, or are they this organized crime syndicate? And mm-hmm. that's going to let you know what they're targeting in you, right? Necessarily, but until you're like giving those board level presentations where right. where you can be like, we need to know that. Right now, you're getting there.
Right.
You're better than a lot, But I think that's where you build into that structure is why it becomes important. And I'm a little long on that.
I do want to ask you, so there can be a long time frame when you're trying to like get to attribution. What would you say is the fastest you could get to a pretty confident attribution? And what would be some of the longest you would say?
Wow.
So I'm going to, I think we've got it's somewhere between 75 and 100 named groups. Mm. That's where we've got direct attribution. Mm-hmm. We know down to, some individuals, right? But there's tens of thousands of groups that we're tracking that we have ideas from a nexus. Yep. We know what they represent. And some of them we've been tracking for, a decade.
Right.
So it could be anything from some poor schmuck kept his home directory in the malware that he was compiling, and that made it really easy. But
they're not all that good, folks.
But we're not all that lucky. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What do you think, John?
So I want to address the one point when you said you don't worry about the who, Chris, is often. I think that there can be. A vital mistake, and the reason that I feel that way, and I do probably have a little bit of a biased opinion since the type of attacks that I investigate, but to my customer, there's going to be a huge difference if it's a group of students out of a science technology university in Hong Kong that are doing some sort of compromise against my bank, to where once we can mitigate that threat and get rid of those resources, they're not going to be able to do a lot more. They're not going to have the money, the funding, or the time. But if I tell you, again, not to pick on North Korea, but North Korea is going after your bank, you can stop them today, and they're going to come back five different ways with different tools and different malware. So I don't mean to pick on what you said at all.
No, I do
strongly think that the who can make a difference, but there are times when attribution is good and times when it's not, and you need somebody who's walked the walk and has the expertise to know when you need to dedicate resources from your organization to spend on attribution, because you are right, it doesn't always matter, but when it does matter, it really matters. So I guess that would be the only thing.
No, I completely agree with you. Like, if you have an organization that has a super mature, big intel team, then, and this organization's like aerospace, so they're constantly getting hit by potential APTs. But let's say you have a shop that has a single intel analyst, and they're trying to manage the incident. If they're like, hold on, everybody, I'm trying to figure out who this is, then that might not be the best use of this.
Sure. Yeah, you won't get there with a team that size.
No,
right. No, I think generally speaking, what I've always said about attribution is there's two reasons you care about it. Either A, you can do something about it. You're a government entity that can shoot back. You can arrest somebody. There's something you can do. Or the second one is as you're trying to work towards proactivity. So again, if we understand who did this, then we can dig into their background. We can try to figure out where it fits, say, on the kill chain. We see they're in stage one. We can look through and see what will be coming next, right?
And we can look at what they've done before and get some clues as to where to look next before they do it.
I think Chris makes a valid point in terms of practicality, right? I know Chris pretty well, so it helps. But I know he's not saying it doesn't matter. He's not saying it doesn't matter. I know what he's saying is I can't make that my first thing, and I absolutely agree with that. You got to work with the people you have. I got a small team I'm building up. Let's start with the what and the where and the how. As you get more mature, as you get more people, you work towards the who, which allows you to become more proactive. You start moving from reactive to proactive, but it's a process. I'm with you. Most teams aren't blessed with millions of dollars and dozens of people right out of the box. So that's why we rely on vendors.
I was going to say, how much value is there ultimately, if we think about this long term, in depending upon the organization size, for you versus for somebody in, say, the Fortune 3 to somebody that's barely able to pull together a $200K for their security op.
Right.
We're thinking about it from that perspective, how important is it for you to do the attribution yourself versus rely on your partners to do the attribution?
Again, I think it depends on the maturity and the size of the team. If you don't have the time, you don't have the resources to do the attribution, if you have partners that can do it for you, then that's all the better. It's one team, one fight. And I rely heavily on the vendors that I bring in from an intelligence perspective, because I just look at them as an extension of my own team.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. All right, let's get into the case study we've got here, right? So we've talked a lot about how to build programs and a lot of the theoretical things. We got into some of the more tactical pieces about how adversaries are changing and how difficult it is to attribution and whether that's important or not.
So we're going to do a quick review here on APT 30, or APT 41 or Gref, depending on where you came from. And the reason I found this to be a really compelling case, and actually it's Tim and John's, is because both these guys have worked on this and from different angles. So let's just jump into this case study and see where we go from here. So APT 41, quick overview of what APT 41 is, so the whole room probably doesn't know. John, do you want to just give like the 5-second speech on it?
Sure. So APT 41 is a nation state from, well, they're from China. And they are involved in long-running attacks against the U.S., other countries as well. But they have a gambit of custom unique tools that they use. And there is sort of what brought on this conversation was there was a mix of the activity. So there's all these unique custom malware tools being used. And they had two group names being tracked for this activity, because one of set of activity is what we traditionally saw, which is a nation state. And then we saw some of these tools starting to be used for cybercrime. So that's kind of what started our conversation here, is how do you attribute that? Do you put that into one group because it's the same people behind it, or do you track it as two groups? And what's the answer? And that's sort of what the conversation that we began to have, that's kind of how this started.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just to clarify, I'm going to put both these up there. So that's the conversation you were having at Symantec, right?
Well, me and Tim were having that conversation. Well,
you guys were actually talking about that.
All right. So I want to understand the differences. So Symantec and FireEye both have reports on this activity, both have reports on this group. I'm really curious about the similarities and the differences in how the two companies approach these and how the products went out. Because having read all of them, they're all valid. They're great work. Like, I mean, not to, you know, pat you guys too much, but they're great work, right? They really are. They're really solid. If you guys haven't read the products, I recommend talking to these guys about them. But I want to understand and help the audience understand what the difference was.
So I think, and I'll talk 1 second here. I think it's important you guys know the end result, though. We did it differently. Okay, so we track them as two groups. FireEye tracks them as one group. Neither is wrong. We wanted to kind of talk about the differences and what we thought about how it affects our customers. That's what's generated the conversation. More so than APT 41, but anyway. Yeah.
That's exactly it, right? And because of the nature of how we approached it, right? We started off with two organizations based upon, you know, our internal structures, but ultimately we consolidated them down into one APT 41 group. And simply put, was we were focused primarily on assessing the motivation and understanding that there was tie-in between a number of the indicators that we saw in both of these campaigns at the criminal level against the gaming industry, as well as the video game industry, not gaming, not gambling, as well as where we saw sort of these ties come from the cyber espionage side of things, focused on specific other specific targeted industries, whether it was high tech or telco or whatever. We were focused on the personnel components of it, right? And understanding that the people behind the organizations that ultimately led that. And so coming at it from what I would consider a human intelligence driven background, that's how we ended up with the idea that this is a single organization with two separate mindsets, and ultimately people moonlighting. Is what we came up with. It came out of it was, you know, groups that were working during the day and then taking off and doing very similar work using the same tools or similar tools at night, and just, you know, what they needed to do to launder money.
Yeah, so looking at it from the human perspective, the human intelligence perspective, I can understand very well from my past life as well. So it does come down to the different ways that organizations look at it. You know, it's Symantec. You know, we don't get into the human persona part of it as much. We just don't. So for the way that we tracked it was sort of putting the activity into buckets. This, you're using the same tools. We agree with FireEye's assessment. They are the same people behind it. But to us, for the way that we track stuff, the way that we break this down, the way that we, or even our internal systems, the way that we store IOCs and things, it made more sense for us to caveat it into two groups based off of the activity. We agree, same bad guys. Just, again, for us, it made sense. This is the cybercrime element. There's some different TTPs with that, so we kind of track it separately. Here's the espionage that's long been running a lot longer than the cybercrime piece has, but they both had some different aspects to it, so we just sort of separated it out. There's not a right or a wrong answer, though. It really, the end result is how it helps your customers. You know, the way we deliver the information and do that, that's what worked best for us. But it does cause, that I think the next question is going to be, is you know, what happens with your customers or with even the public, whoever it is, there's all these frickin' names.
Yep.
We're talking about the same entity here, and right now we've got all these different names. And then we have different names. Even if we called them this one group and FireEye called it one group, we'd still have different names.
Yeah.
Well, now we've got three names for one group.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, we've got two names for it, as you can see up there. You had two names for it, for the activity as well. We consolidated into a single name, but still that's three names, and we leave poor Chris in the lurch here.
Well, and that's thank you. That's the good question, right? And that is the next bullet. So Chris, we've got all this going on. And again, these are two guys talking about one activity.
Yep.
We got hundreds of these. We got dozens of vendors talking about hundreds of activities. So how do you, how do you manage that? How do you make sense of it, dedupe it, figure out what you trust and what you don't trust? How do you get all the names sorted out? Like, what's working for you right now so that everybody understands what we're talking about?
I think the best way to put how I manage it is barely.
I love an honest answer, man.
I've been in organizations where I was like, you know, let's do a Rosetta Stone and just like get all the names on there on the same sheet. There's a pretty, extensive Rosetta Stone that's out there that people have circled around on a Google Sheet. But still, even if you have that Google Sheet, you tend to get mixed up. It's like, oh, is this the bigger, you know, APT organization? Is this a subset organization? Are we talking about the same thing? Are we talking about the same language? That's where it gets problematic, because if you have a gap in communication because you don't understand that you're actually talking about the same thing or you're talking about two different things, that's when you run into trouble. So I think both Symantec and FireEye, they do a great job at, you know, explaining what exactly they're naming. Mm-hmm. But I do find that there are some folks or some researchers that can muddy the waters a bit. And so I think that's the biggest challenge when it comes to dealing with all the names in the alphabet soup.
Yeah, I agree. And for anybody who doesn't know, the Google Sheet that Chris is talking about, if anybody wants, you know, afterwards, just ask one of us. I'm sure we all have the link. I know I have it as well. I'm happy to give it to you. It does help. I will say, in the past, one of the things I've found useful is technology here sometimes. That Google Sheet's great, and I have it, and I've ingested it into most things. But this is also, and I apologize, it'll seem self-serving. It just is what it is with the technology. It is one of the arguments for things like threat platforms. Is that brings everything together, and you can tag everything and correlate everything and get something that makes a little bit more sense. So it helps. It's definitely not the solution for everything by any means, and there's a lot of challenges in this area. I'm with you, Chris. It's the bane of, I think, every Intel professional's existence in the private sector is, even if it's great Intel, I got to still get it all on the same page and make sense of it. Yeah. We got all this going on.
There'll never be one name for a group. It's a marketing thing. You know, it's not at the analyst or even at the security level. It's a marketing thing. One company's not going to want to use a name that's associated with one of their competitors when they're writing articles or white papers or blogs. So it's not a problem we're going to get rid of soon, unfortunately. But I do think it is a major problem with customers, with analysts, with other entities. And we honestly, is at the analytical level, we all work together. I mean, we talk, we communicate about this stuff. So it's not only a problem for the outside world, you know, it's something that is, you know, security analysts and researchers that we deal with as well. I just don't think there's going to be a good solution for that anytime soon. So we do try to caveat that, and I think most vendors do that by, you know, documenting the behaviors, documenting other names that other vendors might call it, things of that nature.
I like to make the joke of I'm really good at tagging all of my MP3s, all of my music, and they've got really great tools for that. And I have, like, you know, those tools are really good for me to use on my music. But when I hand that saying that to somebody else, it's because I've called it something, you know, some genre that I've invented, even though, like, nobody else gets it.
No, your disco punk, I don't understand at all. Like, that's definitely a you thing, just so you know.
Yeah.
All right, so So the last piece here, that covers it for our panel discussion. Just a quick note on some of the things we hope you took away from this, then we're going to do some quick Q&A. You know, based on this, you should be able to do a bit of an assessment on your Intel organization, whether they're aligned with the Intel cycle. Hopefully that helped a little bit on the front end. Hopefully understanding the challenges and pitfalls of attribution and how challenging that's been. And then recognizing that there's more than one approach, right? Tim and John brought a great example of two very different approaches to an adversary, both very much correct and both very useful for customers like Chris. But there's just different ways of going about it. As you know, as John mentioned, Symantec doesn't focus as much on the personalities of the adversaries, but more just the technology. And then being able to examine vendors. We didn't talk as much about this as I might have hoped going in, but it is important to understand if they're making logical conclusions, if they have fallacies, and that comes back to analytic standards and tradecraft. So we're going to do some follow-on Q&A on that. I'll also be here all week, and so will these guys if you want to talk about tradecraft and how to actually poke your vendors and find out if their high confidence is really based on anything, which will help you when you do your collection plan. So I want to thank all three of you guys for taking the time to come out here. I was so excited when you said yes to doing a panel, so I appreciate it. They're the three smartest guys I know, so I was lucky to get all of them. And we want to open up for some Q&A if we've got anything available.
No, we're out of time.
I don't know.
What are you going to do, kick me off the stage? You got any Q&A? Don't listen to this guy. We got a couple minutes for questions if you want.
Yeah, you'll find us around, too.
All right.
We got one.
We do. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Hey, I was wondering if you guys know what the outcome of the OPA Anthem Primera, that whole rash of attacks.
Oh, OPM?
OPM.
Yeah, the
not
OPM.
Not OPA.
The
Anthem. OPA is
yeah.
Mars.
Yeah.
OPM, yeah.
Yeah. I can give my hypothesis. I'm sure these guys will have an interesting answer.
The answer is yes. We worked on that for like 4 years ago, and it took law enforcement a long time to put together the evidence that would need to put together an affidavit, which you probably are aware has now been released.
Yeah.
The reality of it is the names of the people that are in that, while it's good and it sends a message, those are not the people that are actually, that would be meaningful to impact. So it is a step in doing it, going in the right direction, but I think that's more from a political venue that's going to benefit, but I still think it's great to see governments getting in line with at least making some noise that, hey, we're aware that this is happening and it can't continue, even if they know it, they're not going to actually be able to apprehend someone on Chinese or Russian soil.
Yeah. My question is, early on in the research, Sophos came up with a theory and that seemed to map the attributes of the Sacula malware across a number of these different attacks.
Sure.
And they seem to have attributed it to a 5-day period where there was a top sec cup
yep. mm-hmm.
competition between Beijing University and mm-hmm. and government sponsored.
Yeah.
So has that actually, was that what came out in the
That was part of the evidence that was used to leave that led to the rest of some of those individuals. But they absolutely, that TopSec organization was not only putting on those hacking competitions, but they were training PLA officers that were, this is all public information, that were taking part in these attacks. And we know that they were correct because, like I said, those affidavits sort of confirmed that research was accurate. But that specific professor that was behind that uh-huh. is known and also been linked to working at some of the labs that developed the malware that we saw in both the OPM and the Aetna and healthcare Anthem. Attacks. So, or
got
Anthem,
it.
Thank you.
Got it. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm being told I can't take the next question, but if you come up here, we'll talk to you.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.